I'm Joan Cartan-Hansen, and welcome to Science Trek, and welcome to EBR-1. This experimental breeder reactor was one of the world's first electricity-generating nuclear power plants. We're going to take a tour inside and find out why this place is so special. Okay, we're now in the EBR-1 control room. I'm with Don Miley, our tour. Don, tell us about where we are.
Well, like you said, this is the control room. This is where they would start the reactor, stop the reactor, control power level. All the other panels throughout the room would monitor different systems, primarily the cooling systems. That's how you pay attention to what the reactor's up to. But this was it. This is where they would operate the reactor from, is right here beside us.
Now, this was really new technology. This was groundbreaking stuff.
This was groundbreaking. Prior to this, they'd built reactors at Hanford for the weapons program, but this was the first time they said, hey, let's use it for peaceful uses, let's make electricity, and this was the first place in the world anybody did that for electricity.
So what happened?
It worked. You know, the bottom line, it worked. They brought it up to power, they generated electricity. And from that day in 1951, December 20th, 51, up through the end of 1963, they were running experiments. You know, what can we do with the reactor? But while they were doing it, they were also making electricity. They turned their own lights on every day when they came to work out here, literally.
So what are we looking at when we're looking at the room?
So as we're looking at this, we've got different indicating lights to let them know where safety rods are, power levels. It's really quite simple. It's like driving a car. You want to know how fast you're going. Same with the reactor. You want to know what power level are we at? How much energy are we putting out? And it really is, for all of the as complicated as nuclear can be, it's a simple turn it on, turn it off. How fast do you want to go? How much power do you want to generate? And that's really all we have here. It may look complicated, but it's not. So Joan, here we are on top of the reactor now. Through this plexiglass, you can see a plate. That's the top of the reactor vessel, kind of like the lid on a pressure cooker, for lack of a better analogy. And this is what their fuel looked like. They had fuel rods that were that big around, 10 feet long, but only 8.5 inches of the actual fuel to make the heat. And that's where one of the really unique things about nuclear power comes. It's energy density. So in this reactor, they had 8.5 inches of fuel, and with all the rods together, it was about that big around. So think about the heat generating area was about the size of a football, but it heated the coolant from 440 degrees to 600 degrees at 300 gallons a minute. That is a lot of heat for something that size. And that heat was then used to turn the water to steam to spin the turbine and generator.
So where are we now?
So we are at the point of the plant. This part looks like any power plant. Doesn't matter. Split atoms, burn coal. If you can make steam, you'll spin this generator, which through all this gearing will spin the turbine, just magnets past wires, and you make electricity. The significant part here is where these four light bulbs are, we are replicating what they did on December 20th, 1951, when they lit four 200-watt light bulbs. First time in the world a reactor made that much electricity. My favorite part of the whole thing is the wall where everybody that was here, almost everybody that was here, signed their names. In charge was Dr. Walter Zinn, a Canadian physicist. He had worked directly with Enrico Fermi throughout the Manhattan Project. Directed the fourth name down on the left side, a guy named Reed Cameron, said, write something on the wall, we're all going to sign our names to it. They recognized this was pretty significant. So Cameron wrote that, and almost everybody that was here signed their names. The names that are up there, the 18, are all the men that worked here. The men signed because they were project personnel. The women were told support personnel, nurse and secretaries, no. However, the bottom name on the left, Jolly, he was the janitor, he signed. So in 94, during National Women's Month, we did hang a plaque because this is a National Historic Landmark. We couldn't let them sign their names, but we did hang a plaque to get their names up on the wall finally.
So why is EBR-1 such an important place?
I think it's important because, number one, it's in Idaho, which I think is pretty cool. But it proved everything they set out to prove. They wanted to prove they could make electricity from a nuclear reactor. They wanted to prove they could generate more nuclear fuel than they used and that they could do it all safely. And they achieved everything. Everything they set out to do, they achieved. And what was learned here led to so many other bigger things, to what is now 20% of the electricity for the United States, 16-17% for the world. It started right here. This was the first place to make electricity from the atom.
You can learn more about EBR1 and nuclear power on the Science Trek website. And while you're there, take the 360-degree immersive tour of the building. You can also check out my science blog for kids and connect to our Facebook page for teachers and parents. You'll find it all at idahoptv.org/sciencetrek. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time on Science Trek.
There we go. Now we can see 34 layers of glass.
Presentation of Science Trek on Idaho Public Television is made possible through the generous support of the Laura Moore Cunningham Foundation, committed to fulfilling the Moore and Bettis family legacy of building the great state of Idaho. By the Idaho National Laboratory, mentoring talent and finding solutions for energy and security challenges. By Walmart and the Walmart Foundation, increasing access for Idaho's children to explore the possibilities of science and technology and sparking their interest in careers that shape our world. By the Friends of Idaho Public Television, by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, and by viewers like you. Thank you.